In the summer of 1996, Native American tribal leaders and researchers from all over the world met for 5 days near a Yankton Sioux reservation in South Dakota. It was revealed in a dream that now was the time for the tribes to break their silence and share their hidden knowledge of the Star People, the visitors from other worlds. The Star Knowledge Conference has continued for 19 years, but this was the first. We'll meet people with firsthand experience with ETs, hear amazing stories of the unknown, and witness a mysterious event which occurred in the skies. For some, a visible sign from the Star People that we are not alone.
It seems that the traditional American people, the tribes, have an ancient prophecy. They have some ancient wisdom where they have been taught for centuries that the time will come when they must share their secrets and their close, intimate relationship with the star beings.
Oh, this conference to me is a milestone. Many of these elders have never spoken in public before. They've been afraid. And with good cause.
This conference is a test to see what's going to happen.
And all of these indigenous so-called primitive peoples have the same message.
There is a strong feeling, particularly among the men called interpreters here in the Dakotas, that many of the beings that they communicate with are from the stars. And Lauren had told me just before, in December, before that gathering, that he had had a dream that this was sort of the first and that there would be more, which would in turn usher in the 1,000 years of peace that you've heard over and over again here.
And in the dream, he was standing there and I walked up to him. I said, "It's time to teach now." So he stopped and he was looking at me. About what? I said, about the Wichach Peoyate. That's real short, sweet dream. I asked them in the most respectful way that I could. And they said yes.
There's a saying that we red people say, and it's Mitakuye Oasi, which means all my relations.
It's an awareness of the relatedness of all of creation. Here they say, Mita kuye oyasin, me, my, takuye relations, oyasin, all of.
When we say all my relations, then we're saying a prayer for everything that the Creator has created, the trees, the animals, the bugs, other life forms.
It deals with the human species, the human race, who and what we are.
It's to help us to grow, to understand, and not to be afraid of the Star Nation.
This gets into the realm of pure spirit as to who we are and what we're all about and where we're going. And once people come to terms with that, God, we have an unlimited future. The American people have been kept in the dark on this from the very beginning. Because some arrogant bureaucrat somewhere decided that the average person was incapable of dealing with this. Good God, we can't tell them this. They're not going to be able to handle it.
We're not going to change the system. The system is going to dissolve and people are going to change their lives. If they're waiting to hear it from the official version, then it's not going to be the truth. Because we're in the business on this earth of perception management. Whether it's religion, school, education, government, doesn't make any difference. Somebody wants to run somebody else.
The harassment towards people who experience positive UFO contacts is quite bad.
On the basis of that, the licensing boards waded in and without any real investigation, never talked to me once, decided to begin a process, really a kangaroo court process of taking my licenses. They got a current Army colonel, who happens to be a psychologist, to testify that anybody who believes in this stuff has got to be crazy.
I've been harassed in Norway. My house has been robbed several times. My telephone lines have been cut. There's total harassment with my faxes, and my mail is stolen.
And their cover-up and their lies are falling apart on them. It's unraveling. And I think a lot of reasons for that is that the communications revolution, the World Wide Web, the Internet, the fact that people now can talk to each other within a second all over the world.
And it is basically a policy of official denial. In fact, the movie on TV by that name does a nice job of summarizing the official government policy. As the general said in it, we don't lie, we deny.
Because ETs do exist. There's absolute medical proof, there's absolute scientific military proof. There are crashed craft, there are craft that have landed.
Along with that, they're also now accelerating the pace of releasing information to the public. So we're seeing more and more media-manipulated movies. We're seeing more and more good documents leak out. Just this spring, we've had a couple of the Apollo astronauts finally freed up to Gordon Cooper and Edgar Mitchell to say that, yes, they've seen UFOs, and the government's covering it up, and the ETs are here, and they've talked to some government officials.
You hear the story about Roswell. That was one of 12 incidents that happened within 2 years in the Southwest. We had them in Texas, we had them in New Mexico, we had them crashing in Arizona. We had alien disks coming down all over the Southwest. And aboard there were little bodies. Some of them were alive. Some of them were kept alive for a year and a half to 2 years.
But you do have also, in my knowledge, 131 humanoid bodies in deep freeze. But the general public is never told this, and officially you deny it.
Now the second cover-up is the really dangerous one. This is by a rogue outfit that is not part of the official government, contains apparently some people from private defense industry and some probably former military and intelligence officers who have taken the whole UFO project kind of private and are taking recovered craft and recovered bodies and sequestering this information so that they can make great profits by retroengineering the technology. And these folks basically want to hog the situation for themselves and keep everybody else in the dark.
It's just a question of power and also a question of religions, because the religious dogma will collapse. Not spirituality and not anything to do with God. Of course, they always remain. But the dogma will collapse. The human ego will collapse. We're not the peak of the universe. In fact, we are Stone Age men.
We're having national policy being made by people in Washington and other places. And these guys are making policy affecting all of those lives. And they were not elected to do this. They have no authority to do this. And I have to tell you also, and this is an extremely sensitive issue, is that it isn't just governmental operations. There is corporate involvement here in this lie and in this cover-up. Because this technology, this knowledge that they have been able to glean from this alien extraterrestrial technology is literally worth trillions. I'm talking about anti-gravity. I'm talking about technology so far beyond anything we could even imagine that the guys involved with it say it's even beyond Star Wars. It's the greatest story in history. It hasn't been told. The people have a right, and the people have a need to be told the truth.
The most important thing and side of the whole question is spiritual. And of course, that doesn't interest the military. They're only interested in craft that have a technology which is thousands of years more advanced than ours.
We live in a huge experiment. The entire creation is an experiment. And it's an experiment that is allowing anything to take place. Their life is just looking to see all the possibilities. One of the possibilities is that we can appear to be separate from everyone else. And so we're exploring what that is, and we're not the only ones. There are in this galaxy alone, there's about 80,000 other planets that are exploring that same possibility of what it means to be separate, where most of life, and that means the vast majority of life, has no idea what that means. They're coming from a place where there is only oneness everywhere.
And I feel that all the changes that are happening today are absolutely rattling the core of humankind so that we will awaken to our spiritual heritage, our spiritual truth. So how does the average person discover this? Well, they have to want to, number one. And sometimes people who don't even want to discover these things, you know, they get hit by lightning or get in a car wreck or, you know, something traumatic happens to take your attention off of normal 3D so that you have to begin to consider something else.
Our brain is a computer, and what we are receiving is information from our higher self, from our angels, from our guides that travel with us, because we cannot do this earth walk alone. So in some sense, we are all channelers. We all have to have this telepathic ability to receive messages. And the key to receiving really clear messages is to have a clear brain.
People turn to God and they start having recipes to follow God, you know, prayers and restrictions and restrictions of how to approach the invisible authorities. Yeah. And then what happens is they began to move beyond their faith, and this is what's the theme of today, that people will be led beyond what they believe.
What if you were to know the moment you were going to die? Would that affect the way you're going to live your life? A lot. And what it does is it keeps you out of the moment, which is what all your spiritual teachings are trying to do, is to get us into this place where we're living in the moment.
So as I began to learn critical thinking, I began to question everything that was official and the things that were said, oh, this must be this way, or don't do this, or don't do that. Those were the areas I realized that held very powerful so-called occult knowledge that were the keys to show us that we're not just third dimensional beings. There isn't just everyday tables, chairs, living and dying and that's it, and obeying, paying taxes, showing up and being on time. That there are mysteries, and that the people in power have always known those mysteries.
All along, we have had spirit beings help us. If these could be interpreted as extraterrestrial beings, then they would have a relationship. And maybe they do. Maybe there's a parallelism. We are dealing with mystery. But my people, the Sioux people, have a connection into the beyond that most other tribes do not have. And definitely dominant society does not have that connection. How do we have it? It's because we honed it down through time. Also, our philosophy, the way we think, the way we think of the Creator, it doesn't block that out. When we contact into a spirit being in the other realm, it comes into ceremony. It knows things that we don't know.
The big difference between us and the ETs is on that experiential awareness level of consciousness. What did they do to us by forcing us to investigate them and to learn about them using consciousness? They forced us to realize our own nature in discovering them. They forced us, by dangling themselves in front of us like a carrot, they forced us to go after them, and in the process of discovering who they are, we discovered who we are.
It's wrong. The truth is out there. The truth is in here. Truth is right here in everybody.
And the mysteries are kept from the commoners so that they can be managed.
Remote viewing is a trainable mental procedure that uses the mind to remotely perceive, meaning to perceive at long distances or across time, physical objects, people, anything. And a genius came along, a guy called Ingo Swann, who was a natural remote viewer, was able to perceive physical objects, houses, people, whatever, at distant locations anywhere on the planet. The reason he was a genius is he figured out what his mind was doing when he could do these things. And then when once he figured it out, he said, well, then you don't have to be a natural psychic. Once I know what my mind's doing, you can train this to anyone. What we are doing now is investigating the physics of the soul. We are investigating the mechanisms by which the soul interacts with the physical bodies. And ultimately, the big game in town is to go past that and to find out why we souls exist. And fundamentally, we need to know who, what is the basic nature of God, himself, herself, itself, whatever God is. We are now at the foothold of understanding what that being is all about. And we're using this originally developed military technology to investigate matters that extend all the way, scientifically, verifiably, reliably, right to the heart of the matters of who we are, the nature of God.
We always say that we should have free will, and we do. You had total free will, whether you were born on planet Earth or somewhere else, whether you were born white or red or yellow or black or whatever, what country, what culture, what background, what parents, and what was the motive of that free will? It was your lessons and learnings.
We are all connected intimately. There is only one spirit moving through everyone, and any other interpretation of that is just illusion. It isn't true. There are spirits that are coming from very high levels and they're descending, and they appear to be dark. And there are those that reach the bottom of the level of consciousness that the experiment is in at the moment. And at that point, those spirits naturally begin to go up into the light. And we keep cycling around. There is no really hierarchy. It just appears that way at any particular moment. Each one of us is God, literally.
There's an airplane that crashed down here at the University of South Dakota. Well, actually crashed between Denver and Sioux Falls. And it was a speech team coming back. And the pilot got lost in a blizzard, had vertigo, crashed with five students aboard and the pilot instructor, which is him. It was in the wintertime, and the snow come and buried it up. For a month, the National Guard looked for that plane. Couldn't find him, they called off the search. I called him. In those days, you call a holy man, you call a police station, because holy men didn't have phones. So you call a police station, they sent a squad car out, he's on the phone. Nephew, understand you're looking for me. I'm not his nephew, but we talked that way. He said, I know why you're calling me. He said, you want me to find those six bodies, don't you? He already knew. He had a ceremony the night before. We laid out maps for him, and he drew a line from Denver to Sioux Falls, the destination of the plane. And the lights were turned out, and this drum sounded, and it's something like this. And a beautiful song come out, and a lot of chanting, and woof, spirit world comes in. And they come in the form of little lights. I know this sounds strange, but we are not dominant society people. Things happen different with us. These spirits come in form of some, like electricity spark. They're energy. Gray Weasel came in, who happens to be Bill's spirit guide. Maybe he is an extraterrestrial being, but he is a spirit guide. This is a mystery nobody can explain. He came in and he made seven predictions. He said, you will send a plane out with a man and a woman because life is balanced. Great Spirit makes everything balanced. So that would be Carol and I. Animals will show you where to go. So we'll do this within a day or two and these other things will happen. We took off out of Vermilion Airport. Deer were coming out of the trees. They pointed downstream, we went downstream. You'll come to a creek. And that will lead you to a creek with the same name. South Loup Creek, L-O-U-P, and Middle Loup Creek. Went to that creek, animals point us upstream, we went up. You'll come towards the town, you go across that town, and animals will point you another direction. We went across Arnold, Nebraska. You will fly right over the plane, but you won't see it. It'll be covered up with snow. But you will be forced to the ground. That which forces you to the ground will expose the plane. Fog came in and we were forced to the ground. But we got back over the creek, we got back over the river, we were low. and the fog was right on the bluffs. We barely got back to Vermilion Airport. But you'll be smiling and laughing, so don't worry. We were laughing when we put the plane in the hangar because we were alive. Within a day or two after you do that, two people who are not looking for the airplane will find it, and they'll be led by an animal. Two coyote hunters were led by a coyote, and that which forced you to ground will expose the tail. The fog had melted the snow in the tail. When you find the bodies there, there will be five together. There will be one way off distantly. So look for another one. The sixth one will be distant. It will be a girl. She's the one that used to wear them big glasses and with a Chinese-type haircut. Sure enough, it was a girl of this description. Her seatbelt came loose, and she went right through the fuselage. A rock came in to that ceremony. It hit me. I jumped right in Connie Bowen's lap, the president's wife. It scared me. He says, "Eagle Man, reach down and pick up that stone." He says, "You shouldn't be so scared." And there was this white stone with all of these inscriptions on it. Now, this stone was made millions of years ago by a creator. And yet, upon that stone were these seven symbols. There was a coyote looking back. There was an airplane with the tail sticking out. There were like two people walking behind with tracks. There was South Loop Creek, Middle Loop Creek. There was the girl's face with big glasses and Chinese-type haircut. That is mystery. And it's no contact with the devil. There's no evil spirits. The polyester world will say, Sunday polyester world will say, "Oh, that's the devil," because they don't know. And it was a good thing that we did, because we wanted to find a body so that the parents would find some relief. We were not doing a bad thing. But that is an example of contact into that spirit world that lies beyond, that these Indians have maintained.
Well, I came to the ufology field actually because I was challenged in a way. I met Andrei Buharich, who brought Yuri Geller to the Western world in a conference here in this country. And he was claiming he was flying with UFOs. And of course, I couldn't believe him. I mean, after all, he was a respectable medical doctor. But then I said to him, "All right, if you do, why don't you take me along?" And he took me quite seriously. And he said, "Well, where do you live?" And I said, "I live in Lapland by a riverside at the Arctic Circle in Finland." So he said, "I have to ask for permission." And I wondered by whom or from whom. 2 months passed and I was at home reading a book of poems with a girlfriend. And the name was First Contact of the poem that I was just reading. And then I looked out of the window and got a shock of my life. There was a craft 100 yards from me, 100 yards from the earth. And we both went to hysterical panic. And I couldn't understand it because I had said, "Just come, you know." And why did I go into panic? I found an explanation later because an American colonel told me, who is a UFO expert, that they have an electromagnetic field around them. And that causes paralysis or panic in animals and humans who come close to it. And if I was just 100 yards away, they have a 300-yard field around them. So that was the reason. Well, it was there for 15 minutes and then it flew away. And then, of course, like all contact persons, we tried to denied and said, "No, it was the moon. It couldn't be. I can't have seen a real craft." Until next morning, the local papers said that over 100 people had reported seeing exactly a craft or something, lights, whatever, over there. And then the Lapland Air Force said in 2 days, it was a Soviet rocket that stops for 15 minutes at my window and then says, "Hi, Rauni-Leena," and then continues. That was confirmation for me. It was, of course, a UFO, but I did not know that that night I was abducted, as you say. That came out 3 years later when I was hypnotized in a PSY conference in Switzerland. So I'm not afraid of them because being a medical doctor, I was just, I could almost say, envious of their medical technology.
And I was in Withfield, Virginia, children's home. And we were all outside. I was playing pick up the jacks, and the other children were playing jump ropes, like children will do. And about this time, the lady we called Mama Hallie came out of the building, screaming and hollering, "Come in, come in." And I'm out there, "Gee, what's going on?" And about this time, telepathically, I was told to look up. So I looked up and I saw the craft right over the top of the house. But I do remember that night, I'm in my room, I'm sharing a room with another little girl, she's sound asleep and I'm singing and playing. And I see this ball of white light coming out of the ceiling. And it's floating on down and it's coming across the floor. And I pull the covers over my head. I am 6 years old and I got scared. And about this time, this ball of white light manifests into this being. The being was very tall, beautiful, had blue eyes, no hair, little bitty mouth, had a long white gown on. And she put her hand on my shoulder, and she told me not to be afraid, for I was one among them, and that they would be back.
Se alzó de repente.
It raised
lentamente.
Slowly raised up.
Se desvaneció.
Then it vanished.
I went upstairs, looked into the night sky, and concentrated my thoughts and asked, if you're there, I'm here, and I wish to exchange. And if we can exchange a sense of our realities and our cultures, I would do it, bring it to this world in world service. And I think that was a real big key, the sense of service, because the extraterrestrials are looking for people to bring light and illumination, which is awareness and wisdom, to this planet. Well, about 2:30 in the morning, I was startled awake by three very, very tall silver cosmonauts. These cosmonauts stood about 7 to 7.5 feet tall and literally glowed like the sun. They were dressed literally in silver spacesuits, literally like out of a 1950s movie.
Just as I started to go down in my car, I saw something pulsating over there to my left, and up, going about a mile and a half, it came up on the rim, and it was going over above the ground by maybe 100 feet. But it still didn't register. And all of a sudden, it dawned on me, that is something that's flying and breathing. And my car went dead, and I kind of, trying to slide in through my car seat into the ground, and I barely left my right. And it was pretty what I was watching, because it kind of angled like that and shot straight through the clouds as a blink of an eye. And then maybe a minute, 2 minutes later, my car got all well. And within that week, I had my stroke, where the feeling in my right arm, my right leg. And since that time, I have crazy markings up here on my body.
And we looked up, and in the sky, you could see a huge gray mothership. And they are also very long and cigar-shaped. And it was very dark, and it was the darkness of a void. It had taken on the form of a cloud. This form was not only not giving off energy, it was taking energy.
There's all kinds of different story of what they look like, but actually they look like this. And then two eyes and two nose and a small mouth, long chin.
And there was so much energy, all of a sudden, this huge black cloud, it wasn't even gray, it was a black cloud, left. It just disappeared. And what I was told is that this is happening all over the world. The energy is being taken up so much. It's kind of like little germs that are living in your body, or little viruses. They have a great time living there, but if you do something like oxygen therapy or whatever, or take herbs and you raise the vibration of your body, all of a sudden it's not comfortable for them to live there anymore, and they have to go.
And when she had the sexual contacts, afterwards she was shown, not a baby, but a teenage girl, and she was told this was her daughter. And this was a hybrid. And there was just love between them. But this daughter couldn't be on this planet for a long time because of our atmosphere, because of our pollution.
What would be the point of landing on the White House lawn? If they make a major overt contact with the human race, they want to do it with a representative of the planet Earth. And who do we have, literally, representing the human race and the planet Earth? We don't have a very structured, cohesive organization at the most. We've got the United Nations, which is fragmented, which is fussing and fuming and fighting all the time, just much like Congress.
A number of people in the media coverage of close encounters with extraterrestrials are portrayed as scared and feeling traumatized and not wishing this would never happen again. We find a much different reaction in other countries that have not had the negative benefit of the American propaganda machine, where people don't have any pre-existing prejudices and just take it as a plays and generally roll with it well and even feel privileged about the contacts.
In my context, do you have the religion? Not the way you do was the answer. I said, do you have God? Of course, the same as you do. And I said, well, you know, we have different concepts of God. What is God? The answer was, God is love, the energy of love.
I happen to know from firsthand inside experience that they have had major contacts with senior military officers. There were a couple of Air Force Major Generals a few years ago who had personal contact with them out there in the Mojave Desert, where they were invited aboard the ship and taken for a ride. Two generals by the name of Robert Scott and another general by the name of Glenn Miller. Now, these men had personal contact with extraterrestrial intelligence, humans.
Our current science has no explanation for an extraterrestrial coming through a wall in your bedroom to visit you, or even more amazingly, pulling you and the extraterrestrial back out through a glass skylight ceiling without you breaking it and ending up with a bunch of glass in you.
They would like to gently raise our consciousness by showing themselves slowly and gently into a way that we were not fearful that they're going to come down and take our real estate, turn us into dog food or whatever.
I had a CIA agent that was in a class that I was taking, and sometimes they take my class and I just let them be there because there's a reason why they're there, and there's really nothing that they can't hear. And so I was talking to him about the Greys, and he's all into denial about the Greys' existence. And I could see that he was lying to me. I could hear it in his voice. I could see it in his face. And he was asking me questions, just like you're asking me questions. And he was getting into what I was saying. And then all of a sudden, just spontaneously, he said, "What happens to them when they die? They die, you know." Now, if he didn't think they existed, how does he know that they die? I thought that was pretty funny.
I've seen beams of light come down from the heavens and then spread out and then come back and then go down to the ground, to Mother Earth, then come back and spread out again and then go back up to where it come from and then disappear.
Of course, we are always focusing on the body, so people are mostly scared the first time they see, and I was scared the first time too, because, you know, when you see somebody who is about 1 meter high and looks like Spielberg's E.T., you're a bit insecure when you realize that that entity is much, much more advanced than you are, technically and morally and spiritually. But then when you accept that the form is not important, but the energy, the spirit in that form, like in our form, then you can communicate. And the communication is always telepathic.
Kind of look like on the movie Close Encounters, when the mothership and then there was some smaller ships and then tiny ships all around it. The next day on the news they said it was space junk, but they were trying to lie to us.
The Galactic Confederation people that I have seen basically look like us. So whether these lizard people exist or I just don't know.
And I have seen pulsations, energy pulsations that turn into a physical craft. So as if it would start from an energy and then become physical.
They're still physical. Many people think that most of the ETs are dimensional beings. The human ones that are coming here don't seem to be. They just seem to have types of technologies where they can move through walls, make themselves seemingly invisible, and it's beyond our comprehension to understand how they're doing it. So I think many people are misguided into thinking that they are some form of apparition or whatever, and it's probably just technology that we just don't understand yet.
Okay, if you'd like a good metaphor for what's going on in outer space, the Greys, and I lump the Greys into one category, there are several races from other planets who wish to take over Earth and to have our destiny. They want all of the humanoids off of this planet. And they could be literally thought of as Darth Vader and the boys. Then the Galactic Confederation, if you want another metaphor for them, would be like Luke Skywalker.
The shoulder to to their elbows, about the length of my shoulder to my wrist. The real long limb. And this, and the sign they give us is this. Because they glow through here, through here. And I didn't know what that sign meant till my 3-4 years later. I met another person who explained it to me, that means unity. So these little things they show you is just to tell people that they're okay. They're not here to harm you.
And the person was talking about how in off hours, they were, after getting bored at listening in on conversations in the Kremlin walls, they were beginning to target ETs, UFOs. And they were getting some remarkable things done. And I asked this member, and I said, well, what did you do? What did you find out? And he said, well, we were going after the pilots originally, and it was very difficult because we had to actually track one of the ships from Earth, where it was doing whatever it was doing, back to its homeworld. By that time, I was on the edge of my seat. And you tracked it back to its homeworld? And he said, yeah, but it was tough because you see, they disappear in the blink of an eye because they go so fast. We had to figure out how to follow it, but we finally followed it and found it back to its homeworld. And then I was really on the edge of my seat, and I said, and then what happened? And this is the same technology that they use in battlefield conditions. I mean, we're talking reliability. We're talking in the laboratory proof, and they were just using it in other applications, the same exact technology. And I said, what happened? And he said, well, we followed the pilot. And I said, well, where'd the pilot go? He went back to his house. And I said, and then what? He was gone for a long while, so he went into his house and made love with his spouse. And we watched, and that was the first time I really sort of felt like an animal. That's what I said. And I sort of leaned forward and I said, $20 million and you all became voyeurs? What else did you do? And they said, well, no, we were interested in other things. We were interested in the ergonomics, the cups, the things like that, what types of stuff they drank from. And then I said, this is not out of any disrespect. You have no idea how much I respect you folks, what you're doing. But like, what kind of government do they use? Do they use representative democracy? Do they vote telepathically? Do they use paper ballots? Are they communist? Are they totalitarian? Are they hostile? Do they have dictatorships? What kind of things? Do we have something to fear? Do they have a galactic representation? Or is it a federation type of situation where they're all sort of loosely grouped? Or is it a tight-knit organization like a parliament that extends to many planets? And the person leaned forward and said, these are very good questions. So at that point, I realized I had a book coming. If I could use that same technology to answer the questions that I was interested in, rather than the questions that the military was interested in. The military was, they didn't do anything wrong. The military was interested in military matters. They were interested in the pilots. They were interested in the ships. They were interested in the technology. So when the person answered back to me that, you know, followed the pilot back to the home and watched them make love to his spouse and saw it as a beautiful experience, that wasn't something wrong that they were doing, but there weren't the questions that a social scientist would ask.
The Galactic Confederation usually has the saucer-shaped discs. They're kind of like a color between bronze and gold. And the gray ship, I've only seen one, and they are like long aluminum cigars, floating cigars. In fact, I have one student, and she will remain anonymous, and she used to work in Army intelligence. And of course, a lot of times, you know, they don't tell you anything, and I don't really want to know anything. I don't. And I was talking to her one time, and I said those ships look like cheap aluminum. And she answered back just spontaneously. She said, and they feel like cheap aluminum too.
I've made questions to myself, why me? Like everybody. I would answer, why not? I mean, there's nothing special except maybe there's something in my background that I am a medical doctor and I'm very known in Scandinavia, but I think there's more to it because when I was 15, I designed our class ring and now I understand. But at that time, at 15, 1955, I had no idea. It was on a blue background, a silver Saturn. And it was a girls' school in Finland and all my teachers says, why this? I mean, why this? I said, I don't know. Now I know that somebody tried to remind me of cosmic contacts, which I have found out through hypnosis I've had since I've been 5 years old.
But I guess the most important thing is that if I were to walk away from this, people might draw the conclusion that I finally decided this stuff isn't real, And I feel quite the opposite, that this is the most important moment in human history since we began, that we are about to meet some of the folks who at least partially are have a very large hand in our fashioning, both as a culture and somewhat as a people.
My name is Lena Whitewolf, and I am from the Cherokee Nation. And I have been in contact with the Pleiadians since I came here. I am a star person. I have come here to help those on Mother Earth, to help heal her, for she so desperately needs it.
I came here from another way of being. I'm not from another planet or anything else like that. I'm just from another way of interpreting the reality. It's called Melchizedek consciousness. And I was sent here in the year 1819. I've been conscious continuously since that time.
That first, when you come into contact with UFOs, the first reaction is often fear because the world collapses. You know, we're not supposed to have that. We didn't learn it in high school. And then, after you get over the fear, you start understanding the meaning of life, evolvement, the spirituality, the unity of all.
They had shown me another planet that we had lived on at one time. And because of ego and power and greed, they showed me that it exploded. And if we do not treat Mother Earth with respect and love, this planet can go just like that planet did.
They're not more aliens than we are aliens to ourselves. It's family. It's you yourself that you're meeting. And if you're very frightened, you're meeting your dark side in a way. It's a very different viewpoint from the religious dogma and teachings, and that's why I have heard that in Vatican they have a crisis committee thinking how can they save the church. And even in a magazine for bishops in Vatican, a priest was writing that also ETs need religion. I guess they're trying to make them into Catholics.
The star people are everywhere. They've been here before you were born. They've been here before your parents, your grandparents. They've always been here.
Why are we here? It's the same question. Why are we here? Why are they here? Some of them say we come to the zoo to look at us. Some of them say we come to look at our past, and they are our future.
And that this is not just a random contact between cultures, but that the ETs are here with a message and are giving a number of very interesting messages to the various experiencers.
Apparently the Pleiadians want to continue something in America where they think there is a higher level of consciousness, and obviously here in America we're kind of leaders as far as trends and things that happen around the planet. They seem to think somehow if they affect consciousness here that that will somehow spill onto other countries with our leadership capabilities.
Most of them seem to come for scientific expeditions because they are researching all planets in the universe, and this is a very interesting planet which differs from many others because we have an individual mind, and most of them, they have a group mind and they're telepathic, so there's no negativity because they can read out each other's thoughts, so nobody can be negative because immediately he will be spotted.
They cannot interfere, but they can intervene. So when people ask them for help, and when enough people of consciousness get together and ask them for help, that's when they can start to help this planet.
They look up. Look for answers up. Look for the star people up. Oh, everything's up. They're right here. The star people are right here.
I am Two Moon Eagle Feather. I am of the chief. I say to you and to all among out there, you have to change your ways. This planet, our mother, is very sacred. Love her. Treat her with respect. Honor her as we did.
The basic paradigm is that we on this planet are an island in a sea.
and the island and the sea gets visited by higher dimensional cultures that have the ability to navigate that island, just as we in our human culture weren't able to even navigate this planet until the invention of the deep-bellied, heavy-ribbed trading ships that could come and go across the world currents. They were a kind of spaceship.
So again and again, the extraterrestrials have come and visited the planet and been a part of the evolutionary structure and raising of consciousness here.
Let's just assume that the universe is vastly intelligent, and we've been seated here on this island to create a certain kind of a resort planet in the galaxy for a heterosexual, bilaterally symmetrical, seed, sperm, egg, flowering, lovemaking, art-making, culture-making, architecture-making, larval forms of God, us.
It's a big universe. There's obviously entities out there millions of years older than we that have kept their planet, and can you imagine the intelligence that they have, so that they can send out communication or vehicles and look.
My Sami friend, who had a sexual contact, said really that she was able to meet her hybrid daughter. It seems that they are really creating a hybrid race, and that is not only to help them, but number one, to help human race to survive, because planet Earth is going into another frequency. The vibrations are going to be much higher, and our normal physical body as it is known today is not going to survive.
And it seems that we and the Soviets had almost gone to war at least a half a dozen times because of these strange circular metallic objects that were flying all over Europe. For a while the Soviets thought they were ours, and for a time we honestly believed they might belong to the Soviets. It became very clear after a time that neither one of us had that kind of technology.
They claim that they have created us, and again, that crushes religious dogma. They claim that we are an experiment, that our bodies are their experiment, but our bodies are not going to last. I see nothing wrong with that, because as a medical doctor, we are doing all kinds of experiments with human beings. We are doing experiments with plants and animals. We're trying to make better races by changing their DNA. Now, when some entity who has a higher intelligence than we do is doing it to our body, we object. Why?
But an incident occurred in early February of 1961, where World War III almost began. And things started about 2 in the morning. It only lasted about 25 minutes. And before it was over, all hell had broken loose. The Soviets had gone on to red alert. The Allies had gone on to red alert. The Warsaw Pact was running out their tank battalions. We had aircraft in the air. The Soviets had sent up fighters. And these events were occurring. Large, circular, metallic objects flying in formation at a very high rate of speed, at a very high altitude, coming out of the Soviet sector, over Central Europe, in formation, very, very obviously under intelligent control. A British air marshal by the name of Sir Thomas Pike, who was the deputy supreme Allied commander in Europe. And Thomas Pike decided they'd had enough of this, that we couldn't go on with this. One of these days, somebody was going to do something stupid, and we were going to have a shooting war on our hands that nobody wanted. Well, Pike got my boss, General Lyman Lemnitzer, who had only recently been assigned. And what they did is they initiated this study to find out what in the world was going on. What are these objects? Where are they from? Do they represent a military threat? Do we have to fear them? We knew by that time that they weren't Soviet. Soviets knew by that time they weren't ours. These objects had repeatedly demonstrated advanced technology.
The galaxy is a living organism. It's alive. It's moving through space very rapidly somewhere. It's been self-organized for a very, very long time. And most of the beings that are within the galaxy are totally interconnected, just as the cells in your body are. They all have different functions, like heart, brain, etc., and they're all working together. And there are parts that are within the body of the galaxy, and we're part of that, that are, you might say, experimenting, kind of. We're doing things that could produce a chromosome breakage, that could produce a new way or a new direction for life. And life is very interested in what we're doing. In fact, we are probably, at this moment, the most interesting thing in the galaxy. You've got just about everybody looking at us right now. The ideal state for us to be in is exactly where we are. We're doing exactly what we're supposed to do. It's perfect. There are four kinds of consciousness levels, if you want to break it down, throughout the galaxy. There are those of the light, there are those of the dark, there are those that are both, and there are those that are neither. And about 95%, I'm just guessing, is neither. They're just witnesses. They're all interconnected. They're just watching, and they're not reacting one way or the other. And then there are those that are really trying to assist us in raising our consciousness. And there are those that are doing everything they can to keep us from raising our consciousness, and that's their job. They're supposed to do that. And then there are those that are both. And they play both sides of the fence. They'll appear as the light when they think that that's what's appropriate, and they'll appear as the dark when they think that's appropriate, and they walk that line. The Pleiadians from Billy Myers and the Pleiadians from Barbara Marciniak fall into that group. They work either way depending on whatever is appropriate for them at that time. And the interplay between all of those is crucial and important for life to continue. It's not good or bad. That's our interpretation from our point of view. But in truth, they all work together.
What is there to fear? There is nothing but love there. Of the light vibration, yes, there are those of the other soul kind. But they are meant to be here too. They are teaching us. I have to go now.
We've developed thermonuclear weapons. We have bacteriological weapons. We have particle beam weapons. My God, we have more than a dozen ways of wiping the human race off the planet. We have not kept pace sociologically and psychologically and theologically. And we're right at that moment, that critical crossroads where we're going to make it or we're not.
I think we're in a fringe of a transformation which is biggest as we know in the history today, but I stress as we know it today, because there's forbidden archaeology which shows that mankind has been on this planet for millions of years, not just maybe 100,000 years with Neanderthal people, because we have found artifacts which are incredible, but that is suppressed, like the UFO question is suppressed, because it changes the status quo of science today.
I believe that the children will be and are one of the primary keys and components in the unfoldment of this new consciousness on the planet. The children just came from God, so they haven't been gone very long. They're much closer to remembering what it's all about.
The awareness that we're not alone, that we have never been alone, that we are apparently part of an infinite community of intelligent life, that the universe literally is teeming with consciousness and intelligence.
There have been children that have been coming here, being born into this world, that are not ordinary, and they're all interconnected. And when the time is right, they will emerge as a consciousness on this earth, and they will lead us into the other worlds.
So what do we learn? Each housewife is more important than the U.S. government in this respect, in evolving this nation, this globe.
There was a child there in China who suddenly was able to do things that we only see on TV, you know, when we make up TV. But he was so psychic that he could anything, and he could know everything that was going on. And then they found another one, and another one, and another one, and then they found 100 of them, and they found thousands of them. And the government actually called Omni magazine over there in 1985 to look at these children to see who they were and what was going on. And so they wrote an article. It's in, I think it was in January 1985. They were going over there as though this was a hoax. And they came back not thinking it was a hoax at all. And they did things like they'd get a bunch of these kids in a room, and they were assuming that there were video cameras hidden and everything else. And they'd just open a book, rip out a page, crumple it up, and stick it under their arm and say, okay, what does it say? And all these kids could read the page perfectly, flawlessly, without a mistake.
And there's nothing new, because we're not the first race who has inhabited planet Earth. There have been races and races and races. We know that even Neanderthal man didn't look like we did. It was much more hairy. It had longer teeth. It looked more like an ape. And now we don't have so much hair, and we have smaller teeth. What about the ET race? Is that our future?
500 years ago, the Renaissance did begin. The Renaissance which would bring forth the kind of people that we are, which is our particular way of interpreting the reality. But from a Native American or a Native person's point of view, that's darkness. That's separation. That's a way. That's leaving the connection to Mother Earth and separating away from it. That's ended up being our demise and our problem. Moving into a place where we don't even think that Mother Earth is important. So we can pollute her oceans and her skies and her waters and everything else, because it doesn't matter, because she's not a living being, just a big rock that we're on.
If we change our attitude, 6 billion people on planet Earth, from hate to love, or at least to neutral, I think we're not going to have so many cataclysms as predicted. And it's not negative, because it's a cleansing.
All your prophecies, if you look at Edgar Cayce, he says that the shift that everyone is thinking about, that which is, he ties it to the shifting of the poles of the axis of the Earth, which people never thought ever occurred on the Earth, though now they know it's happened hundreds and hundreds of times through science, and that and it's happened 13,000 years ago, and it happened 26,000 years ago. It's all tied to the precession of the equinox. And the point that we sit in the precession of the equinox right now happens to be the place that you would predict the poles to shift if you were looking at that data.
So this is why everything is shifting. As we move into this age of Aquarius, Aquarius is a sign of unifying humankind. It's a sign of enlightenment. It has to do with sudden, shocking, surprising changes. It has to do with electronics and technology and big changes.
So there are a lot of changes, but the major change, I think, is that the fear of death goes away. And that is the biggest disease of this planet. Everybody, in general, is so frightened of death. And when you once realize that when you have spiritual contacts with ETs and with your dead relatives, there is no death. There's absolutely no death. There's only transformation of frequency to another world.
There was also a remark by the Pleiadians that most of the biblical prophecies will go down almost 100% the way they are written, because no one is doing anything to change them. As a matter of fact, there is a large group of people, they say, in the power structure on this planet that wants them to happen. Apparently, prophetic things like the Bible and so forth, which has had prophecies for 2,000-3,000 years in it, works kind of like a roadmap for the masses. People read it, think that it's going to happen, get it into their consciousness that this is the way things are going to happen, and they just live with it and they make it part of their lives. They're not aware that they can control their own future and do something about it.
From an astrological point of view, probably the biggest thing that people could understand is the age of Aquarius. And that talks about a cycle of time that involves about 2,200 years. And that not only do we have a calendar of time that we use for months and days, or the calendar we wear on our wrist for hours, but there's this large season in the heavens. And it's called the precession of the equinoxes. And we move through this. And as we move through these different chunks of 2,200 years almost, we have a different theme to the time we live. And because we only live less than 100 years, we say, oh yes, well, we can look back and say the 20s was this, the 30s was this, the 40s was this, the 50s, 60s. But we forget that we live, and our memories are so shut down that we forget that we've lived through these great ages. And then we keep reincarnating and coming back to learn the lessons, to find our own footprints in the sand of the artifacts that we buried maybe 1,000 years or 500,000 years before.
Was there, is there a military threat involved here? And that was the only purpose that this thing was devised for. Did we have a threat to Allied forces in Europe? Well, when they completed it in 64, the document itself was roughly an inch and a half thick. They titled it an assessment. They had a subtitle called An Evaluation of a Possible Military Threat to Allied Forces in Europe. The report itself was shocking and earth-shaking, and every one of us who were there at the time and read it, I think, were affected by it. We had an Air Force officer, a four-star American Air Force officer by the name of Robert Lee. But when he read this report and the implications and the ramifications of it and what it indicated, he was never quite the same. He says, nothing will ever be the same. He says, all of our missiles, all of our rockets, our jets, our fighters, our bombers, our satellites, our nuclear weapons, none of this means anything.
Are into conspiracies. And I would say, yes, every conspiracy that you've heard about is probably true. And conspiracies do exist. So what? So what? When you give your power away and you believe that you're a victim and you believe that life is meaningless or that you have the answer and only you have the answer, then we begin to miss the point. You know, there's more than one flower in the garden. And the flowers don't fight about who's the most beautiful flower.
The traditional Hollywood version of ETs has been the invasion from Mars kind of scenario, although there are some very significant exceptions. The Day the Earth Stood Still is an old 50s movie that I still think everybody should run down the video store and rent and look at, because I do not think that it can be improved on as a message of what the ETs are really here about and how we ought to and how we ought not to respond to them when the saucer lands almost literally on the White House lawn. Also, the movies E.T., showing a well-intended stranded extraterrestrial, a situation we have actually had in human history in recent years, although it's been covered up by the governments, is a good measure of what's going on.
The reason that you see so many television commercials today featuring extraterrestrials selling tires and food and automobiles and things like this is because they're seeding the subconscious of the media to bring out their ideas, and really the idea of extraterrestrials, as you can see, has been bombarding the television set. And he said this was designed just to get you used to the idea. We are like babies to them, and they want to slowly introduce us in the way of scenarios, pictures, fun little commercials, cartoons, much like we would show our children pictures in the same way, just to give us the idea and the understanding, so it is not such a shock to our culture when they do introduce themselves fully.
And in the past, as a culture, we have met entities, energies, extraterrestrial, ultra-terrestrial, ultra-dimensional, inner earth people, all kinds, interdimensionals, and they have appeared to be more powerful than we are. And I would say from the things that I've studied that there are certain of those energies, just like they have their counterpart humans, who are playing the power over game rather than the empowering game. And it's scary, because will we get taken advantage of again? Will we have to meet something once again that will terrify us? Yeah, probably. Probably we will.
The academic scientists, of course, with unfortunately the kind of arrogance that comes with some folks in science, think that everything in the physical sciences has already been discovered and are going to have a lot of trouble with what looks like violations of the principles of gravity and space-time and speed of light limitation for travel. All of those are being violated daily by the visiting civilizations, and there are plenty of humans who've watched them violated.
But we have a phenomenon here that's real only to a handful of few people. But once you cross the line and have seen a real UFO, whatever it may be, seen a craft, an object, or an extraterrestrial face or something like that, you can't really get rid of that. It's like any other experience we have in life. It becomes part of us, and you can't back up and get rid of that. The ETs seem to be very aware of that. They know that they're crossing the line once they have a relationship with someone or expose themselves to someone, it has a major effect on our psyche. Humans are rather fragile. You know, we have a thought mechanism that goes inside of us that they examine all the time. They listen to our thinking, they know how fragile we are, how easily we can become emotionally unstable, and fortunately they're being very careful with that.
And also, if a psychic is a good receiver, be it a little gray person or anybody else, can send the psychic receiver the information that they want that psychic receiver to receive. So you have to be very discerning as to, am I seeing what is, or am I seeing what it is I want to know, or am I seeing something that someone else wants me to see?
It happens to me again and again. And what I have to do is meet it, meet my own fear, and transmute it, and rise above it, and realize that I am in charge, and that if I'm going to put out fear, then I'm finished. And if I put out peaceful coexistence, and I use the vibration of love, then I can neutralize whatever's out there, and it doesn't even find me, because it doesn't have anything to attach to. Fear finds fear, love finds love.
There is a concern in Washington, I've been told by knowledgeable leak sources, about the influence of the ETs on our culture, particularly on organized religions. And I would add that the think tank folks over at CIA seem to be concerned about academic scientists as well as fundamentalist religious groups. Those are the two groups of the general population that they feel will have the most trouble accepting the reality of UFO presence and extraterrestrial visitation.
I have people who come to me with abduction experiences who definitely do not want this to happen, yet they keep on abducting them. And they have, you know, eggs taken out of them, sperm taken out of them, implants put into them against their free will choice. They're probed. In fact, I have one student who was in Sedona. And she was at Bell Mountain with one of her friends, and it was late at night, and they saw a spaceship up in the sky, and you can see a lot of spaceships in Sedona. And the spaceship flashed some lights at them, and they thought this was neat, and they flashed their car lights back. And they thought that was it. They went back to their hotel, and then they left the next day to go home. And then my friend, my student, and I'll just use her first name, Ursula, had like a rash all over her body. And she went to doctor after doctor. Nobody could help her. Finally, one doctor said, I've seen one other case like this, and you might think about, I can't do anything for you, and you might think about going and being hypnotized and see what happened. And she was hypnotized, and she was shocked. She had been abducted, and she was taken up to the spacecraft, and they couldn't do anything to her. And she felt that it was, she was so strong, and she was so angry at them that they couldn't touch her.
Well, the reason we do not need to be afraid of extraterrestrials is that the vast, vast majority of them are like the vast, vast majority of human people. These basically decent folks that, if not placed in emergency circumstances or unduly provoked, mind their own business and are well-meaning and reasonably live and let live.
One, they concluded that the human race on the planet Earth had apparently been under some kind of a survey or study for a very long time by several high-technology extraterrestrial civilizations. The historical records were overwhelming. The records from the Roman Annales 2,000 years ago were filled with UFOs and aliens coming and going. The study itself was designed to determine whether there was or was not a threat to us in Europe at that time. They concluded that apparently there was not a threat, which was the purpose of the study in the first place, because they said that the repeated demonstrations of high technology indicated that if they, whoever they were malevolent or hostile, there was nothing we could do.
The reason that they need to introduce themselves slowly to us is because we are headed towards a phenomena on the Earth that has not been seen here for roughly 26,000 years. This is going to be the ascension, where the Earth is going to be birthed into the big picture and made a part of everything.
lately I have had to admit that science is only a very, very small fraction of human life, and we're not here to prove science, we're here to live and experience. And throughout the history of science, it has been proven wrong. The next generation always proves that this was wrong. My grandmother was a nurse midwife, and I have her notes from 1910 at the University of Helsinki Nursing College, how people are treated when, for instance, a baby is delivered. This was science. Take mercury cream and smear it here on the femur of the mother. Now that is criminal if a doctor would do that or a nurse midwife today. That was science. So science is just something that we have agreed upon, that we accepted today, and it changes generation after generation.
I mean, a lot of people thought it was the CIA that did remote viewing, perceiving at long distances in the, you know, with the mind. It was never the CIA. The CIA had a very small project and it was discontinued abruptly soon after it started. It was the DIA, the Defense Intelligence Agency.
Einstein kept Madame Blavatsky's secret doctrines on his desk. Nowadays, people start to read them for education. So the scientists who touched the edge and understood the moral and spiritual and political issues at some point in their lives did reach for more. They had to look past science to get there.
What they did was demonstrate absolute, certifiable, positive proof of the existence, believe it or not, of the human soul. Because you see, remote viewing can't work in the absence of a soul. Because you simply don't physically go to any of these places when you're actually remote viewing. This is not something you have to believe in a New Age sense. It's a scientific, verifiable fact. The body is a machine, and we live within it. We are composite beings, two things merged together, a soul and a body. The original applications of the most modern form, the military form of remote viewing, the US Army form of remote viewing, were somewhat unfortunate, in the sense that they were used for assassination attempts, finding terrorists, bombing attacks, location of people to kill, things like that. In fact, at one time they were originally being designed for use in battlefield conditions. The trouble is it took so long to do an accurate remote viewing session, you're talking a minimum of an hour, minimum, that by the time it was used in battlefield conditions to target mortars and things like that, you're dead. I used it to simply investigate the ET, UFO phenomena with that same level of accuracy that was used under battlefield conditions. It was accurate enough for the military to be able to say, we're going to put people on the field and, you know, risk their lives based on this type of information. It's also accurate enough to investigate the ET, the UFO phenomenon. We found out that the ETs knew all about our efforts and, in fact, were very supportive of the use of remote viewing, scientific remote viewing, for gathering information about that. And you say, well, why should that occur? Why shouldn't they just land on the White House lawn, that proverbial statement? Because if they landed on the White House lawn, we would be kept in the daycare camp of the galaxy for who knows how long. It would reaffirm their physical nature, our physical nature. The big difference between us and the ETs is not on the level of gizmos. It's not on the level of physical technology. The big difference between us and them is on the level of consciousness. They, in general, know, experientially are aware, technologically are aware, with their gizmos and everything, are aware of their composite nature. Two things put together, a physical body and what I call a subspace self, or what other people call the soul, other people call the unconscious mind, but basically the essential being that lasts forever within all of us.
And Jose and I were both exploring the Mayan calendar and had studied the material of that was available at that time by Tony Shearer, a Lakota, who had written a book called Lord of the Dawn, in which he talked about the cycle of the 952-year cycles that began the day Cortez landed on Good Friday in 1519 to begin the conquest of the Americas by the forces of Spain and the Vatican. And that began a 26-year countdown to the end of the galactic great cycle, the precession of the equinoxes, the Platonic year, a 26,000-year cycle clocked by the Mayans as 5,200-year cycles, and brings us to the end of this cycle of human biological history in 2013 AD. In 1986, Jose wrote the book The Mayan Factor, in which for the first time he described the laws of time as those laws are mathematically described by the Mayan calendrical system. And that event sparked off the harmonic convergence, which went way beyond Jose's expectations and became a global phenomena involving hundreds of thousands of people all over the globe in a synchronized ceremony based on Mayan timing systems. There is a natural flow pattern in the galaxy, which Jose and we call the law of time. And it has to do with the very regular cycles of a day, a 28-day lunar cycle, which is a moon. There happens to be 13 28-day cycles per solar year, not 12. And a set of other cycles that occur naturally that code the cycles of Venus and Mars, the Earth around the Sun, the Moon around the Earth, the rotation of the Moon, and the basic shape of the growth spiral in the galaxy, known to the Greeks as the phi ratio. What we discovered through Jose's revelation in 1989, after cracking the Mayan time cycles and understanding these natural biological rhythms, the female cycle, the female fertility cycle, the 28-day cycle, is perfectly in tune with the lunar cycle and perfectly coded by this Mayan calendar. After visiting the Museum of Time in Geneva, Switzerland, Jose came back to us and said he had an idea, a very big idea, that when he went to visit the Museum of Time in Geneva, Switzerland in 1989, it was all machines. And he said, whoa, the numbers that are guiding the laws of mechanical time, 12 hours, 12 months, 60 minutes, 60 seconds, we call it the 1260. That cycle of time has nothing to do with human biology or any of the rotations or any of the revolutions of heavenly bodies. Basically, the timing cycle that we're working on, synchronizing the planet for the last 5,000 years, it's been a growing phenomena, is totally out of sync with the entire machinery of the galaxy, the genetic code, and all human and biological cycles of all life forms on the planet. Just by following the 12-month, 12-hour, 60-minute, 60-second calendar and clock, we remove ourselves from synchronizing with the flow of the entire galaxy. And when you've got a machine as big as the entire galaxy that's very carefully set as a set of timing ratios, we're out of sync with everything. We're the aliens. The rest of everybody are natural creatures. And we see them with the eyes of fear and mistrust. The animals, the bugs, the microbes, the blacks, the grays, the greens, all the extraterrestrials that show up and disappear, because we're out of sync with all of them.
The Schumann frequency is the waveform that comes directly out of the Earth herself. That's been a very fixed waveform. It's been so fixed that the military uses it to calibrate many of their instruments, etc. It's been sitting at about 7.8 hertz for forever, as far as we know. This is changing. It's been changing over the last year or so. It's gone up to 7.8 to out over 8 to about 8.5, and recently we just got a reading back about a month ago. It's over 9 now. That's unheard of. That's incredible. There's a major change occurring on the actual energy that's coming out of the Earth herself. At the same time, the magnetic fields of the Earth are another real important reading on human consciousness, because we're tied so closely to these fields. And these fields have, interesting enough, started to drop right at the time of Jesus. 2,000 years ago, they were staying pretty consistently. They know what they've been for over 100 million years. And suddenly they started dropping down. And then just around 500 years ago, which I personally feel is connected to the Mayan prophecy that 520 years ago, the Mayan prophecy shows where we shifted and went into another age of darkness. At 500 years ago, the magnetic fields began to drop faster and more dramatically. In the last 50, 60, 70 years, the magnetic fields have been going crazy. They're beginning to wander, they're beginning to change. There was an actual shift back and forth between North and South Pole very quickly. In September of 93, for about 2 weeks, the magnetic fields actually deviated so much that the airlines had to change their settings to land their planes for a short time, and then it has wandered back again. And so what do these fields mean?
As the Earth was losing its magnetics, the frequency was also raising around the planet. So what you have here is a graph on a collision course. The frequency is rising very, very quickly. This is why you see the Earth changes the way that you do. The weather patterns moving into one another, earthquakes and volcanoes of unprecedented proportions increasing in their velocity and their frequency. You also have the magnetics dropping away, which has a tendency to bring out the paranormal on this planet. This is why people are reporting everywhere that in some form something is happening on the paranormal level.
I don't know if it's a story, but I heard it from a reliable so-called source. When Gorbachev was in power, that two humanoids came through the wall to Kremlin, and they told Gorbachev that he has to put down the atom weapons because he's responsible partly for this imbalance in the world. And if he doesn't do it, they are going to teach a lesson and cause an accident in Chernobyl. Nothing happened, so Chernobyl exploded. And that day, when Chernobyl exploded, it was reported they saw a UFO above the fourth reactor, and it sent down a beam of light. And after that, the radioactivation diminished by 73%.
We're here at the Star Knowledge Conference of the American Indians, and their prophecies are really interesting. I think they're probably some of the most interesting prophecies in the world, really. Even more than Edgar Cayce or Nostradamus or anyone like this. Almost all of the ancient traditions are now releasing their secret information that they never would release before.
I was given the prophecies from the Mayan, from the Navajo, or the Hopi, and some from the Lakotas. And the instructions for me was not to say anything at this time, to keep this secret. But I see how dangerous these prophecies are because they deal with a lot of things that people are not going to agree with because of the way they were brought up.
To my understanding, the Hopis, they loved the land, but they didn't quite know how to treat her at that time to get food. The Pleiadians came here and they showed them, this is corn. You plant this into your ground. This is very sacred. And that is why corn is very sacred to this day. And that is why the Hopi tribe has a Kachina dance once a year for the Pleiadians, for their thanks for their corn. And to ever see one of these dances is absolutely incredible because they start out at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. Because that's the symbol, they come out of nowhere. And when the Kachina dance is over, you don't see where they go. Because it is just like the UFOs, the starships is what I like to call them. They manifest and they demanifest. See them? Now you don't.
The star people are called avatars. They are relatives. Each of these star people are already here. And I believe time has come that the people should know something about it, not to be fearful.
I'm sitting here openly saying anything that would normally we would never talk about because we need to know this now.
In other words, if you can go to the Vatican, you can't just go in and say, hey, yeah, Pope, old father, can you tell me all about what's in your vaults down there and everything? He tell you go to, you know, where the other guy lives. See? Well, we're no different. We're the same. There's some things that are just sacred. Even an Indian, we can't tell him until he does the proper thing. See? So that's where the gate sort of slammed shut.
There was a man who, an American, a Cherokee Indian, who went around to the different tribes and just to see what was common in all of these prophecies. They see a wave of people dying off this planet, a huge wave of millions of people dying all very close in a very short period of time, like a month or two. And according to them, these people had decided to do this because they were going to leave, and they knew exactly where they were going. And so those spirits grouped into a group and left and will go to another place.
And so they told us that in the old days when they were young, that they too had seen things like this. So it wasn't new. And they saw lights, many lights. And even as a child growing up, beginning this research, we always saw lights. Lights used to come on the reservation a lot. When we'd go to discover them, they'd wait for a while until we were pretty close and they'd disappear. But you always got the feeling that it was like a person.
Then the American Indians see another wave coming very, very soon after that, of another huge amount of people dying off the earth. And then a third wave occurs. And this wave is interesting because these people are more like vagabonds. They know they have to leave, but they don't want to go to any particular place. So they're just like throwing their backpack on and taking off, and wherever it is, that's where they want to be. And then they say that whoever is left over after that, that we all drop all of our prejudice, all our stuff that we've got, and something happens in the world where we all come together as one being on this planet, that this very sacred space is entered into.
Wakantanka. Wakantanka is the great spirit. Pilamia is thank you. Wichonihe is my life. I've just sung a song to the ultimate, the creator, the mystery. I don't know who the creator is, but I know it's a mystery. And so it's very easy for an Indian to believe that there's life all over. Most Indian tribes in America have been 200 to 300 years under dominant society, therefore they picked up their ways. It is only recently, about the last 20 years, that have Indians started going back into their culture, started to go back into their religion. I know, because way back in that time, I was fighting for the rebirth of our culture to come back out and do our ceremonies. And there were holy men far more braver than me. I was just a young boy, but I remember these holy men would bring the ceremonies out in the open. Most Indians, even in my tribe, were trying to repress our going back.
People have been saying this for hundreds of years, thousands of years, predicted end of time and everything. But this is the first time in our history that we're reaching into our songs and prophecies to share this. Not to change nobody, not to convert nobody, just to share. And if they choose to listen, fine. Not, hey, that's fine too.
The Star People, they're a human being. It's like man is interested in them, but they're more interested in us because we as a human being have emotion. And from what I've been learning and understanding is that the Star Nation, they don't have emotion.
You know, there was a time in 60s and 70s and 80s, if you talk out loud about the visitation and witnesses, government will lock you up or whatever they want to do to question you. But some of us who have physically experienced contact, we know each other.
Have you?
Oh, yes. And I happened to see something alloy white in front of me. I was a tall person, about 10 foot tall, 9 foot, oval shape, large eyes too. And I didn't trust it. Because of my belief, I saw a spirit. But the message in contacting was that, do not be afraid of me.
I have some lab friends because I was 13 years chief medical officer of Lapland. And they partly live with reindeer herding. They're not nomads anymore, but they have wigwams in the summertime when they go with the reindeers. And I have some friends who have continuous UFO contacts. They are psychical or physical or both. And they're quite interesting. Like one PhD lab lady said that she even had a intercourse with a humanoid. It wasn't a hilarious experience, she said, but she wasn't frightened. Like in America, I've heard that with the sexual encounters, people are very, very frightened. I think we we in Scandinavia take sexuality in a much more normal way. Nudity, for instance, is nothing.
And the legend that we were given, prophecies, is that there was going to come a time when the yellow people of the East, the Asian, were going to break their covenant. The covenant is the water, the blood that runs in our body, and the rivers of the earth. And when they do that, my grandfather said they were going to pollute the bloodstreams of Mother Earth when they pollute the bloodstreams of our body. And that was growing opium, dope. And the second covenant they talked about is the European brothers. Their covenant was the air that they were to protect. And the story and the legend they tell us is that when they do break their covenant, they're going to destroy the ozone, and they're going to pollute the air with airplanes and manufacturers. And the breathing was going to be hard, and there's going to be a lot of lung problem. And the third covenant that they talked about was the fire. And that fire is protected by the black people. That is the energy force of our heart. And when that covenant was broken, the black people became very angry, emotionally angry. And that was lost. So then we started to have heart problems, stress, through anger. And the fourth covenant that was given to us was the Indian people. That was Mother Earth. We too were supposed to protect Mother Earth and teach the people, but we neglected that. We became what you call a captive mentality. The great healing is in process.
No matter where I come from, the information is we have got to, first of all, before we move on, take care of our Mother Earth. You could look at her as a launching. And if we don't take care of the launching pad, you can't go to Cape Canaveral and shoot a shuttle up in the sky if you got cracks all over your base. It won't work.
As a child, they had shown me floods, fires. I saw people on the streets dead, buildings burning, people screaming in the streets. And if that soul does not take that transition with the energies that are coming, they're going to be lost.
At one point on this journey of the Earth, the Mother Earth was put into repose, went to sleep. And when she did, there had to be someone to speak for her. And so the red race came from far to be those spokespersons. We were the gardeners. Why are so many people from different places suddenly coming here from the stars? I think some of the people walking around on the Earth today were put here so that they could gather. And they're gathering because this is the last oasis, this Mother Earth, Sikata. There's a spiritual word that says, Sikata Udajua'u. Hoho Hyogaku. What that means is, my mother, in all your softness, you are sacred.
I had an experience myself, you know, about in 1980, I had some energies that came in my bedroom. And I guess most people would call it probably an abduction experience, but abduction to me implies that you were not involved in this process and you didn't create your own reality. So I use the intrusion phrase. It was an intrusion where something intruded into my reality and I felt violated, scared, terrified.
Because I've been meeting a lot of other avatars, people who have met and been anointed. And we pick each other up in the malls, you know, we eye contact, we know each other, we have something in common, we smile. There's an energetic spiritual charisma attached to this context. So you meet these people, you automatically know, oh boy, they're full of love like yourself, you know. And you exchange friendship right away.
They seem to create a hybrid race for our own good. In fact, we are a hybrid race already when you go to the question of the origin of man. Where did we come from? Did we evolve from an ape? No, I don't think so. I think we were seeded from different planets as an experiment here.
That right now I feel our whole world is 80% negative. Small portion of 20% is positive. And this turn of this century, I feel, is that the good ones will eventually win out when the uneven number comes, 21, 21, 21, 21st century. That's what they let us see.
I'll do these ETs. I'll allow them to speak through me and use my voice because I know ETs are real because of the experience I had years before where they showed up in my bedroom. So that's how I, on a logical level, I know they're real. And on an intuitive level, makes sense. And besides, if you travel around the planet, it's the buzz everywhere. I mean, it's the story in all ancient history. It's just not taught in the United States. What I learned in school has really very little to do with what the Pleiadians have taught me. As a matter of fact, their whole worldview is very radical, and yet it feels completely right to me that we have a purpose, that we did not evolve from apes, that we are a genetic experiment, and that our deepest lineage has to do with those who come from the stars.
I have understood that all planet life, all plants, animals, humans, is genetic engineering, which they have been going on and doing for thousands of years. We are the result.
And those who come from the stars are not necessarily human. They're not necessarily in the same line of time that we're in. And they've been interacting with our planet since the very beginning. And these are the deepest secrets that have been hidden from humankind for many, many reasons.
If you think about it, I've heard numbers as high as 50 million people living on the northern continent here of the Americas pre-Columbus. This was decimated down through disease over a matter of years, literally 5-10 years. And so when the first Europeans really arrived to look things over, what did they see? They saw pristine forests, animals. And if you think of 50 million people today disappearing overnight, what would you have? Trash, landfills.
So when the papal forces came here to invade, they were operating under the doctrine of discovery, which stated that the number 13 was the number of the devil, and that all mathematics not endorsed by the church was officially devil worship. So according to that doctrine, unfortunately, all Native American civilization was declared satanic, and the conquerors were given the right to slaughter every Native American they knew who could count.
And maybe when Christopher Columbus set out, you know, 500 years ago or whatever, that it was that same kind of season where that sudden shock of what the world was really like had to be integrated. And yet Christopher Columbus didn't discover the West because it was brand new. He discovered it because he had old maps. There have always been old maps, and there's always been a history of our planet that's been hidden.
I've come to the conclusion after many, many years of research that we're not simply dealing with UFOs. That's a small thing. If that had been the whole story, our government would probably have told us this a long time ago.
And for whatever reason, there are those who have their own intent to keep mysteries from the people. And this is why I feel the earth is all out of whack and people are out of whack, because the power of what we live on and who we are and our heritage is not being spoken of.
We apparently were dealing with some intelligences, some advanced, I mean very advanced intelligences that appeared to have multi-dimensional source and origin. I can't even tell you what the hell that means.
At first, it was a stretch for my imagination, because my idea of ETs was, oh, they're going to land. A ship's going to show up in the backyard, and they're going to land, and then they're going to walk out, and I'm going to meet them, and then I'll know who they are, and they'll take me for a ride and the whole thing, you know? And that's not been my experience at all.
In the Bible, in the Old Testament, the New Testament, in the Quran, in the Bhagavad Gita, the same single story is told again and again and again. We are a created hybrid race. We are the product of some vast laboratory of some kind. And that apparently the human race is not an accident. We're not some cosmic joke. We didn't just happen. The Darwinian theory of how we evolved from the apes doesn't even begin to hold water. I no longer investigate UFOs landing. I no longer investigate abductions, contacts, landing marks, and any of that. I have files that are filled with this kind of information.
When we as human beings think, where did it all start from? I don't think there's a single human being who can scientifically prove and say this was the case. We have hypotheses, and we have a right to think whatever we want. But the main thing is that we realize that we are spirits, we are energy.
This involves who we are, as a race, as a species. How did we get here? Why are we here? And where are we going?
I was reading a book, Mysteries of the Strange, and in that book is a picture and a very short story about the Mitcher Hedges skull. I didn't know a damn thing about it, but I got a message, you're going to get one.
So it's not so much the shape of the ancient crystal skulls then. What it is the consciousness, the intelligence of the people who are the creators of this, and why are all these strange phenomena going on?
We go to his house, and he opens a very old wooden box, and there I confront this guy, and the name E.T. came through, so I called him E.T. And if a person is sitting in front of it, it can ask for a healing, be it physical, be it spiritual, or even ask for money. Specific.
Many people talk about that many of the ancient crystal skulls could be communicators with extraterrestrials. So I think that this skull image that it chose is, number one, it's like an image that we're accustomed to. You know, we're looking at a person, we're looking at their head, so we can kind of relate to another head.
I said, I'm fine. You're not fine. You have the biggest brain tumor ever seen in anybody's head. You should be dead. 6 days after my second operation, I left the hospital and never went back. Then I started to understand that this has something to do with it.
And I had an inner earthquake or shock that occurred to me. And when I looked at that picture and I knew that that artifact existed, a voice inside of me said, now you know within yourself, this is your proof, this is your sign that all these ideas about UFOs and the transformation, this is all happening now, and this is why you agreed to be here.
One day, I'm sitting there and I thought, well, I could handle a couple of millions. So I said to my angel, can you send some millions to me? Next morning, go to the bank. This lady on the counter said to me, do you like to have some 32 million? And of course you think somebody's joking. Come home, and suddenly a voice said, look at that receipt, two receipts, 32 million. I thought very fast through my head, that must be drug money. So indeed, one day later, it was away. And I never asked the bank director nor the manager. I thought it's gone, I don't want to have anything to do with it. So if you ever come in touch with ET, you better be very specific with your questions.
The cover-up of the UFO reality is the longest lasting, most expensive psychological warfare operation ever conducted in the history of the human race.
And I feel that all the changes that are happening today are absolutely rattling the core of humankind so that we will awaken to our spiritual heritage, our spiritual truth.
When you have a cover-up operating on national security laws and principles that threatens people with death, with very long prison sentences and forfeiture of all pay for military and astronaut retirees, you've got a very powerful weapon for keeping people's mouths shut.
My elders and uncles, aunties, they talk to things that they have seen, but they really haven't come out with the things that they've witnessed when they were probably my age or younger. Because at that time, if they talk to those things that they've witnessed, then society would say, well, you're crazy and you're lying. We don't believe you.
A writer came to interview me on my books about human intelligence, which I had done two of in recent years. And somehow the discussion moved to from intelligence to mental ability to awareness to some pictures on my wall. And without realizing it, I said a little that became the subject of the article. And next I turned around, it said Aliens Among Us under my face on the front of a local newspaper.
In fact, a recent Scripps Howard newspaper survey taken last year of public attitude showed that over half the American people think that UFOs are real, and they also think that the government's covering up something about it.
Scientists, they've tried to analyze it and come up with their own interpretation. And the interpretation that they gave is nowhere near to the interpretation that the Spirit gave to us. The crop circle is the circle of life. And the nucleus of this circle and the circles that go around the nucleus represent the four societies. The inner one, it represents the white society. The Creator, when He gave them their way of life, He also gave them a responsibility of fire. And today, you can see what the white society has done with their responsibility as far as the fire. They've created bombs. And the second circle around the nucleus represents, or the black society, and how also they too were given a responsibility, and their responsibility is the water. They've forgotten it, so through pollution, herbicides, pesticides, it all goes into the water, and we drink this. We call water Mini Wichoni, which means water of life, because without that, then there's no life. And then the third circle, if you notice, there's no circle within that circle rotating around the nucleus, which represents the red man. It seems to be in balance with the nucleus. The red man is in balance on a spiritual level, but if you look at it on a physical level or a human level, we're just as unbalanced as the other societies. And the responsibility that He gave to us was land. The outer circle represents the yellow man. And the responsibility and the way of life that the Creator gave them was to take care of the air. They have factories all over the world, and pollution gets into the air. Where the nucleus is and the circles around it represents spirituality, the way of life, and how we all are inside of that way of life, because we were all given a responsibility, we were given a way of life by the Creator. And the circles around is the other nations throughout the universe. You may know them as aliens, ETs, but we call them the star nation. Wichach Beoyate, that's star nation. And they're watching us. and they come in when we need help.
And this poll was taken a little more than a year or so ago. And in that poll, usually what happens in this poll is that the top one, two, or three is usually sex or violence. That's what we're mostly interested in. And suddenly, in one poll, in one 90-day period, a dramatic change happened in the United States. And the poll went from sex and violence, which dropped way down on the line, to a brand new entry came in that was never there before, and it went all the way to the top, and that was ancient wisdom. And as far as I know, it's still hovering up toward the top. That has changed the nature of a lot of the shows that's going on, the whole thing with Discovery Channels and all these, the Learning Channel, etc., and the kinds of things that are coming out. Though, of course, that's an interpretation by the media of what ancient wisdom means. You know, they think that looking at ancient temples and ancient sites and going into ancient history is what they're really wanting. Well, that's part of what they're wanting, but they're really wanting something much deeper.
Why is it that the Ogallala Sioux and the Rosebud Sioux and the Hunkpapa Sioux, why is it that they've retained this knowledge? It's because we've been protected by geography. My reservation alone is about 100 miles by 100 miles. Geography protect us. We could go back into the Badlands and do ceremony and not be discovered. We hung on to that because of our geography, our distance, but mainly time, less contact with dominant society. And you go into the Southwest, those tribes down there have had 400 years or more contact with the Spanish church. They've even picked up skinwalkers, they picked up evil spirits. We don't have a devil, we don't have an evil spirit. But we don't have this force because our concept of the Creator doesn't make such a thing. I've never seen a devil. I don't care if the white man believes in it. That's what the white man believes in. That doesn't mean that I have to believe in it. I believe in what I see. Have I ever seen the Creator? I've never seen the Creator directly. I don't expect to. But I see every day what the Creator makes. I can pick up a bouquet of flowers and hold that bouquet of flowers. I know the Great Spirit is kind and is very artistic. Bees come and sniff the flowers, they make honey. Birds sing. Those are all beautiful expressions of this Creator. So the Great Spirit gave me my life, why should I fear it? I live because of the Creator. So I don't fear Creator, I don't fear evil spirits, and yet we have contact into the spirit world. And that is what is powerful.
I noticed I saw a circle. I wasn't quite sure what was it about. And then we drove out there, figured we might as well join the circle. Then when I looked up, I saw this huge circle cloud right at the same length and same shape as the circle that was on the ground with the people holding hands.
Now, the other clouds had all blown away that were the same altitude, and these had stayed. Now, clouds don't do that. They usually move with the wind.
What really caught my eye was this big white cloud, that it wasn't quite as transparent as most clouds. It was more dense and more white, so you couldn't really see through it. And that was right next to the circle. And I also spotted a couple of little dots of clouds in like formation. It could have been the spirits wanting to share something with us in the Star Nation. The meaning of that circle, I think, is that they want to tell us that they're here and that they want to give us more messages, and they'll be here.